Come watch a new documentary from KCET's Artbound about LA's punk scene, Chinatown Punk Wars. Then stick around for a live performance from the pop punk group The Linda Lindas, hosted in partnership with LAist and Grand Performances. Tickets at laist.com/events.
LAist Studios.
Today on the LA Report, in one of the largest lawsuits of its kind, California sues the world's top oil companies. The DMV expands at-home written tests for some drivers, but that doesn't mean it's open book.
It can tell if you're looking away from the computer.
And new washing machines in the state may come equipped with a microplastic filter. Later, a film location scout takes you on a tour of downtown Los Angeles to explain why the city can so often stand in for other places in film and television shows. It's Saturday, September 16th. I'm Julia Paskin. That's all coming up on the weekend edition of the LA Report from LAist 89.3. But first, here's the latest news. California is suing five big oil companies, ExxonMobil, Shell, BP, ConocoPhillips, and Chevron. The state claims they are major drivers of climate change. And the companies also are allegedly lying to the public about fossil fuel risks. The civil suit proposes a fund to lower future climate change impacts. The suit was filed yesterday in San Francisco Superior Court. In other news, some drivers can now take the written part of their DMV driving tests at home, including Californians under 18 and people moving to California from out of state. DMV spokesperson Anita Gore says the department has figured out ways to keep people honest.
You have to agree before you take the test to be monitored, and you're monitored through a webcam. It can tell if you're looking away from the computer. It can tell if there's somebody in the background giving you information.
If you pass, you'd need to go to a DMV location for the rest of the application process. If you fail, you can take a test a second time at home. For more information on the program, go to LAist.com. And if you do hit the road, it may cost you right now. Gas prices in LA County are up for more than 30 consecutive days. We're now averaging $5.73 in LA. That's up a whole 23 cents from last week. A new generation of chatbots is getting good at dispensing medical advice, according to recent studies, but questions remain over how best to integrate them into our healthcare system. Stephanie O'Neill Pattison of KFF Health News has more.
Chatbots are based on technology known as generative artificial intelligence. An Emory University study published in June analyzed how well the popular chatbot called ChatGPT could diagnose medical issues. The study found the chatbot compared quite well to human doctors reviewing patients with eye problems. Another study published in July by Google computer scientists about their own chatbot found that sometimes it did even better than human doctors. Still, many doctors believe AI-based medical tools should undergo government approval, similar to approvals for new drugs and medical devices. But so far, there are few signs rigorous testing of AI for safety and accuracy is imminent. Meanwhile, OpenAI, the company that developed ChatGPT, urges consumers against using the technology for diagnosis of or treatment advice for serious medical conditions, but it has not blocked medical advice. I'm Stephanie O'Neill Pattison.
In other news, polyester, nylon, those materials are actually types of plastic. And when we wash them, these tiny microplastics get into our water. Now, a bill awaiting the governor's signature would require special filters in new washing machines. Anya Brandon is with the Ocean Conservancy, a group behind the bill.
Some of our partners have estimated that nearly 4 million pounds of microfibers enter California's ecosystems each and every year from washing machines alone.
Opponents say the bill will drive up the price of a washer in California. We'll be right back after this short break.
I'm Jacqueline Stewart, host of the Academy Museum podcast. This season, we're talking about casting. And in our first episode, we'll be diving into the drama behind the scenes of casting the Alfred Hitchcock 1940 classic, Rebecca, and answering the question, how did casting work before casting director was even a job? We'll hear from film historian Patricia White about Rebecca's legacy and how tensions on set led to life imitating art. Listen wherever you get your podcasts.
Welcome back to the LA Report. I'm Julia Paskin. There are a lot of things about Los Angeles that make it unique, but the look of the city and the greater LA area can vary quite a bit. And that means it can also be disguised as lots of other places on screen. Film location scout Rick Schuler is an expert at finding LA spaces that can pass for other cities like New York or San Francisco, or different time periods like LA in the 1960s for the 2019 movie Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, or LA in the near future for the 2013 film Her. Schuler recently took the How to LA team and host Brian De Los Santos on a film location tour of downtown LA.
What you deal with here is like we got the trees we got to take away, the lamps you have to take away, but the architecture is all here.
Our first stop was the James Oviatt building near Pershing Square.
Maybe one of the best representations of Art Deco here in Los Angeles.
It was built in 1928. And if you look in from the ground level, you'll see the covered, partially outdoor lobby with beautiful glass columns that are lit from within.
There's a penthouse up there that's like amazing and amazing views and a little clock tower. But it's great architecture. And in filmmaking, we're always looking for great architecture if it works for the story. So there's Art Deco throughout here and throughout LA, but it's disappearing little by little, like with everything. So this one has done really well. I mean, the interior restaurant space we used on Mr. and Mrs. Smith, the exterior we used recently as an outdoor Italian cafe from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
The first floor used to be a men's clothing store. Now it's a restaurant cicada.
I've never been here. Lived in LA all my life.
I love to hear that.
And because Rick knows the people in charge, we got the okay to go inside before they were open.
So this feels New York to us. And so we wanted something that was grand. We wanted something that was opulent. We wanted space. They're dancing, so there's sort of a dance floor here. The height gives us room to light. The reflective nature of what's in here also helps and sort of creates a mood.
Can you explain how LA captures different eras, different feels, and different cities sometimes?
I think we divide the city between like the more modern part of it, that would be sort of west of Hill, and then everything east of Hill gets into older, it's Broadway, it's Spring, it's Main Street, and that can play for New York, can play for Chicago, can play for parts of San Francisco. Then you have the more modern area, which, you know, unless you're identifying the Library Tower, or you're identifying something, you won't necessarily know it's LA. And then neighborhoods, like we all go to Pasadena, South Pasadena, to get like what we call the Midwestern look, clapboard houses, Craftsman. We go to the West Adams District to kind of get a variety of things there. And I mean, the Valley has all kinds of things. You know, when we worked on Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, it was 1969. So that's kind of preserved in the Valley. You know, it's sort of single story, two story buildings. And then there's the ocean, there's piers. So there's a lot of stuff in LA and the weather. I mean, we used to be able to count on the weather. Rain is sort of our issue, though heat is becoming potentially something. But yeah, LA has all these locations. And the fun part when I started back in the 80s is that you're just driving around and exploring and seeing what you could come up with. So yeah, I think LA has a lot to offer. And the infrastructure is here. And I mean, it was interesting to notice that for a long time people wanted to leave, and that as the actors, I think, got older, they wanted to be with their families. And so there was a push for them to go, yeah, I'll shoot this movie if you do it in L.A. But I think, yeah, more than maybe other cities, L.A. is very adaptable to pass as a lot of different places.
From the Oviatt building, we're off to a more modern building in downtown, the Watermark Tower. It's a 35-story glass high-rise apartment building, all floor-to-ceiling greenish glass with corner balconies that stick out like the teeth of a comb.
So we're coming up on the building where we shot the apartment for Joaquin Phoenix on the movie Her.
Which this already looks like a different type of city.
Right. So this is what I was telling you. It's like there's the city in May is divided in two. Not perfectly, you know, between east and west. And we're gonna have to walk around the back. Let's go down here and walk down the alley because I want to show you there's a remnant of what we did that's still there. On Her, it was a movie that was set into the future, mm-hmm. not too far into the future. And at first I thought that, oh, well, I'm gonna need to find all these super modern buildings and everything. And then realized that, okay, you know, we're walking here and there's probably buildings that are 100 years old, like right around us. Mm-hmm. And we don't think like, oh, well, that building should be there. Like the pantry over there. I mean, that thing's been there forever. So we'll walk down here. You know, now there are many more modern buildings like this to choose from, but at the time it was this one and the one behind it right here.
Okay.
And that one was still under construction, but this one was the hot place. In this case, I had to come in the lobby and I waited like on and off, right? It took me on and off about 5 to 6 weeks to finally make contact with the manager to talk to her about getting this location. So basically, can you look up there and guess which one was the Her apartment?
The one with the weird windows.
That's correct. And the weird windows are clear glass instead of the green tinted glass. And the interesting thing about it is that when I talked to them, we finally got the apartment on board. But after we talked and I talked to them, they're like, oh, the DP goes up and goes, wow, this is really dark in here with these green windows. So he's like, can we take the windows out? And I'm like, whoa, okay, let me go ask. So they were open to it. And we hired a company, Giroux Glass, that does high rises like this. And the irony of the thing is that once we started filming, they go, this is too bright. So we had to create what we call hard gels and tint the windows back from the inside with these hard gels. So of course the producer's going like, okay. But I understand getting the green tint out of there. So I purchased the green windows to replace, but they wanted to keep those because they liked it for film shoots. They do print shoots there quite a bit. But yeah, so it's trying to find LA in the future.
How did you become a location manager for Hollywood?
I kind of fell into it. I wanted to be a college professor teaching history. And then I came out here, I taught in a high school for 6 years, and then I met producers, location scout. It was Alverno High School, an all-girls school, and they did filming there. There's an Italian villa on the premises. So I met people and I felt I had taught, and I taught everything I knew, and I didn't want to be the terrible teacher like in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, where it's like, Anyone? So I decided to jump. I knew a location manager and he took me on to sort of assist him. And I worked at Propaganda Films where a lot of young directors were doing music videos, commercials and that kind of stuff. And I hooked up with David Fincher and he sent me a script for Seven. And then that's how I started in features. And then I did 5 or 6 movies with him afterwards and met other people, and that's how it went.
So you drove around LA a lot,
yeah.
I'm assuming.
Oh yeah. And back then, when I first started, I didn't know where things were. So I would just drive and drive, I mean, for, you know, 10, 12 hours a day. And if it's not for this, I'm cataloging this stuff for future stuff, like where it's gonna be. But back then, LA downtown stayed the same. So once you learned it, you kind of knew it. There wasn't this boom in construction.
And there was no Google Maps where there's like iconic landmarks, right? You had, what do they call the maps though, back in the day?
A Thomas Guide.
Yes, Thomas Guide.
There was a Thomas Guide store right on 6th Street by the Biltmore, and we'd go there and buy that. And then we'd buy the big map that we'd put in our office so we could put pins of where we were shooting so the director could sort of see like what the space is from. We're going to be in Santa Monica, we're going to be in Sylmar and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, no Google Earth. And we did it all by payphones. So you had to figure out what your route was going to be for the day and where the good payphones were that were quiet, they worked, you could have incoming phone calls and that kind of thing. So yeah, I forgot about that.
a short metro ride, hydration break, and parking meter top off later, we were on to 4th and Main for what Rick calls quintessential New York. And there were some points of interest along the way.
Michael Douglas, his point of view before he jumps off this building is at the top of this building.
The building is a high-rise at 700 Flower Street, and the movie was Don't Say a Word, which Rick says not a lot of people saw since it came out in September 2001.
Another, since we're here, this Lebanon Alley across from the arch right there is a great alley that looks at that, and I use that for San Francisco.
Pretty soon, we were in New York City, by way of downtown's historic core. Its borders are roughly Hill and Main Streets and 3rd and 9th Streets, and it's where you can find those cool old theaters like the Orpheum and the Ace.
You can see the fire escapes on the front of the buildings, and the gargoyles and the statues. I think they call it cathedral windows, the rounded part of the windows up top. And they're just beautiful buildings. But if you walk around like most people do, if you look at the bottom two stories, that's a whole different thing. It's not the beauty of everything that's up top. So we are at a couple different locations here.
Okay.
It's where the older buildings are. It's sort of like what we like to do as generic, you know, New York, Chicago, that kind of thing. The streets tend to be narrower, which we like. You can see, like, if you were here, sort of at the intersection of where it's Spring and Fifth Street, like, every corner doesn't betray anything LA. Like, this could be any generic city. On the movie 7, we filmed at the Alexandria Hotel. At the time, I had to go into all of the bad paper day hotels to sort of see what would be the best. But architecturally, we liked what this one had to offer.
Here.
The kind of bay windows that don't come out exactly like in San Francisco, but the bay windows, and then the fire escapes, and then the older lamps. And the bottom has been changed here, but it was older looking. So that fire escape right there, we rigged for Brad Pitt to come down that and chase after Kevin Spacey's character, who was the murderer. And he goes through a bunch of apartments in here. He goes into a beautiful ballroom that was very New York looking with beautiful pillars. And in fact, Brad goes into that and actually, he did his own stunts. He was a young kid at that time. And he cut his arm. So if you remember in the movie, he's wearing a cast.
Okay, yeah.
He did this stunt and then he had to start wearing that cast, which I think goes really well with the movie, but that was why, because he cut himself going through a window up there. And then they chase each other and they go down this alley. And the alleys we like around here have a lot of fire escapes. So you can get a great long view looking down, and these fire escapes just tell us like it's New York, Chicago, that kind of look.
We're right around the last bookstore for people who know where that is, you know?
Yeah.
Have you shot in here?
Yeah. Mr. and Mrs. Smith. Gone Girl. We used to film on the second story here because there was a floor that looked period, which would be old wood, that could pass as a police station or something like that. But on Gone Girl, we were looking for a bookstore that was set sort of in New York. And so the actors were in here as a flashback when they were getting to know each other, Rosamund Pike and Ben Affleck.
As we made our way toward Little Tokyo, we stopped in at the Barclay Hotel.
The Barclay Hotel is like, it's been used in so many movies. It's pretty amazing. We used it on Mr. and Mrs. Smith to kind of be Bogota, Colombia inside.
Here, we'll go in. It's one of the hotels downtown that's now converted into low-income housing.
Hotel Barclay, 158-room Hotel Barclay, the oldest continually operating hotel in Los Angeles. This one has gone through a lot of transformations. We did a lot of filming in here. This was Bogota for us. Though, I think as the president of Colombia, once he saw the movie from Mr. and Mrs. Smith, he's like, Bogota doesn't exactly look like this rundown. So he had something to say about his city.
And on Main Street were a couple other film locations.
That wall over there played the side of the Man Chinese wall
Oh, wow.
In Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, because we needed a parking lot, and the Hollywood Highland complex is there now.
Right.
So, and Quentin likes to do things for real. He doesn't like much CGI or any. So we did that there, looking for the right height of the building, the right corner.
Before our final stop, I realized I needed to be back at the office for a meeting, so producer Monica Bushman, our intern Eden Tashoma, and photographer Julie Leopo Bermudez headed on without me. Their last stop was the DoubleTree Hotel, formerly called the Kyoto Grand Hotel and Gardens, and before that, the New Otani Hotel and Garden, built in 1977. It doesn't look all that notable from the outside, but the filming location Rick wanted to show us was the garden upstairs.
I know, you just walk by and you go, really? You found something here?
Yes.
So we'll just go this way.
And just a note, it's technically only supposed to be used by hotel guests.
So we are at the Kyoto Gardens, which is part of the DoubleTree Hotel. We'll go up these stairs here. And it's a Japanese-themed garden. We chose this location for the movie Her because of its primarily being on the second floor of the building, outdoor, with trees and everything, some hint of architecture behind it. And in the movie Her, it was, I think the year we were trying, it was sometime in the future. I don't know if we actually identified that year, but it wasn't too far in the future. But what we had decided to do, both from an aesthetic and a production reason, was to elevate everything that happened. So they live up in apartments, they walk on bridges between buildings, and this was a place that was a garden that was above ground too. So in the movie, you have a sense that rooftops have become a big thing. You can see trees up there and all that kind of stuff. So we chose this, I think, as the place where I think Joaquin Phoenix meets up with Rooney Mara and they have a discussion and talk about he's still in love with her and she's like, boy, you better get over this kind of situation. So this was both because of the second level, but also the beauty of the gardens and the waterfalls and all that kind of stuff. And it's sort of, as far as the story, it's like he's still hopeful and she's like, no, it's over. So it has a romantic feel, but it's sort of the end of the road for him. It's like time to get real about what's really happening. The vegetation has really grown, I must say, since we were here last. But I hope you can still see the beauty in it with all the different type of trees. There's koi ponds, there's little water features here and there. And then the hotel next to it. I think we also did, we used that corner penthouse up there for something in the movie too. Because you do try to find the key thing in a location, and then because of time, you don't want to keep moving all the time. You try to find something else that could work either nearby or right at the location. I think we shot a Japanese market not too far from here as well.
And how did you end up, did you know of this place, or how did you end up finding out that this was even here? Because it's so kind of tucked away.
Yeah, it's hard to, I know, you're like, where are we going? That's the case with the inside of buildings. That's the case with this. It's like, that's the part of the job I like, is that it's basically hitting the pavement. I mean, it's, you got to do the work. So whether it's for this movie or another movie, I'm like, okay, I'm looking for a hotel. What does it offer? And so you just go exploring.
To hear that full episode of How to LA, you can check it out wherever you get your podcasts, and to see photos from the tour, head to LAist.com. Thanks for listening to the weekend edition of the LA Report. The Weekend LA Report is hosted by me, Julia Paskin, and produced by Monica Bushman, Ashley Rush, and Daniel Martinez. Our engineer is Sean Corey Campbell. The podcast is edited by Fiona Ng. Catherine Mailhouse is the Director of Content Development, and our Vice President of Podcasts is Shana Naomi Crockmall. Join us back here tomorrow. You can read more at LAist.com and listen live on the LAist app or on the radio at 89.3 FM. Listeners like you help make the LA Report possible. Please donate at las.com/join. This podcast is supported by Gordon and Donna Crawford, who believe quality journalism makes Southern California a better place to live.
Out of the Shadows is a podcast on America's immigration system told through the eyes of our Latino community.
I didn't understand how difficult life was going to be being an undocumented person. I mean, I became undocumented at the age of 14.
I'm Patty Rodriguez.
And I'm Eric Galindo. Follow us as we tell the incredible true story of a group of young people who took on the system and changed the course of history.
Listen to Out of the Shadows Dreamers on the iHeartRadio app, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts.